For question number 5, the correct option is option 1. And through the steps of solution, I already have told the question a little lengthy, so follow it carefully. I already gave you a figure in the hint. I introduced that figure once again. This is a right circular cylinder of length L, cross-sectional radius is capital R, and we are supposed to find out the condition for minimum moment of inertia about the perpendicular bisector of this cylinder. For that we have taken an infinitesimal section, that's like a disk, at a distance of x, a variable distance of x from this perpendicular bisector, and this disk thickness is taken to be dx, a differentially small value. Let me highlight this infinitesimal part, that's a disk, in this red shading. And we shall first find out the moment of inertia of this infinitesimal disk about this perpendicular bisector. Now, how do we find that? Well, I shall introduce one more figure for clarity here. If you could have a side view of this disk shown in this red shading, something like this, and thickness of the disk would be dx as already shown here, and I introduce two axes parallel to each other at separation of x. Now this axis is the diameter of the disk passing through its center in the plane of the disk, and this axis is a distance of x parallel to this one, and this is nothing but this perpendicular bisector of the cylinder we are talking about in the question. So suppose the moment of inertia of this disk about this bisector is di. Now how do we find that? This di is moment of inertia of this disk about its diameter plus mx square, that is the parallel axis theorem. Follow it carefully. First, about the diameter, moment of inertia of the disk is, I am taking here the mass of this infinitesimal disk to be dm. In that case, about this diameter, the moment of inertia will be, the formula is mr square by 4. So in this case, mass of the infinitesimal disk is dm, radius is r as usual, dm into r square upon 4. Standard formula for the moment of inertia of a uniform disk about a diameter, mr square by 4. Now, about this axis, which is this one, we apply parallel axis theorem to remind you once again, I is equal to I to center of mass plus md square, m being the mass of this object, d being the separation between these two parallel axes. In this case, it's coming out to be plus, the mass is dm for this disk and the separation is x, so dm into x square, isn't it? We can write from here, this is coming out to be r square by 4 plus x square inside brackets into dm. Now what is this dm? If you assume the mass of this whole cylinder is capital M, since it's a uniform distribution of mass, we can write dm is equal to capital M into dx by L, isn't it? The linear density of this cylinder is capital M by L, multiply that the width of thickness of the disk, that is dx, and you get the mass dm. So you can write down this di is coming out to be r square upon 4 plus x square into m by L into dx. Once again here in the expression, r is radius of the cylinder, x is separation between this perpendicular bisector and the infinitesimal disk being investigated, capital M is the assumed mass of the cylinder, L is the length of the given cylinder and dx is the thickness of the disc being investigated. Give me a moment, I shall come back, making my writing a bit arranged and compact. Now, once we find out the moment of inertia contributed by an infinitesimal element about this bisector, in step number 2, for the whole cylinder, moment of inertia about this bisector will be how much? The required integration for that, I is equal to integration of dI over the whole length of cylinder. Now, this bisector is, you can assume it to be the y-axis, for which the equation is x is equal to 0. And this cylinder is laid along the x-axis, so the left tip is x is equal to minus L by 2, the right tip is x is equal to plus L by 2. So I write the limits accordingly, minus L by 2 to plus L by 2. But because of symmetry, moment of inertia being a scalar quantity, because of symmetry, we can write this as twice integration of dI between the limits 0 and L by 2. In my next step, I keep the limits as they are and put this expression of dI from the previous calculation, giving me, well, just confirm my step, I could write down this is twice m by L, that can be kept on the left, the constant. Then we have inside brackets r square by 4 plus x square dx. In the next step, we are having I is equal to 2m upon L, kept outside, entering into square brackets, I'm having r square by 4, once again a constant, integration of dx between the limits 0 and L by 2 plus integration of x square dx between the limits 0 and L by 2. In my next step, this is giving me twice m by L. Little oral calculation here, r square by 4 kept as it is. When you integrate, this is coming out to be simply L by 2. Verify this. Plus integration of x square giving me x cube by 3. Put the limits. Is coming out to be L by 2 whole cube upon 3. Opening the brackets, let's check 2m by L into r square L by 8. That will be m r square divided by 4 plus then 2m by L into L cube by 24. That is giving me m into L square by 12. Once again, checking quickly, 2m upon L into r square by 8, 2's cancelling out, L's cancelling out, m r square by 4. Next one, 2m by L into L cube by, this is 8 into 24. So 1, 2 cancelling out, making it 12 in denominator, and up there it is m into L cube by L, that is ml square. So eventually I am getting that moment of inertia of the whole cylinder about its bisector can be expressed as I is equal to, if I take m upon 4 as common, we have inside brackets r square plus L square by 3. Remember, looking for the condition for minimum value of I, we equal maxima and minima. So to make this I a function of a single variable, what we can do is that we can write it as m upon 4. And just see what I'm doing. For any cylinder, the volume V, a constant, is given by the formula pi into r square into L. Therefore, I can substitute r square is equal to V by pi L. The purpose is we want to make this I a function of a single variable, that is L, for easy differentiation. So here I could write r square as V upon pi L, V being a constant volume of the cylinder plus L square by 3. Follow up to this. Moving on to my next step, that is step number 3, we apply the postulate of maxima and minima. When moment of inertia I is minimum about this perpendicular bisector, then DIDL, here I is a function of L, DIDL must be equal to 0 when I is minimum. Therefore, we shall set this condition that DIDL is equal to 0 when I is minimum, and then with an I on this expression of I, when you differentiate respect to L, of course M by 4 is a constant, we can just ignore it. We differentiate the part inside because the whole thing is eventually coming out to be 0. That's why I ignored M by 4. We concentrate on this part within round brackets and differentiation with respect to L, giving me how much? V by pi is a constant kept outside, differentiation of 1 by L, giving me minus 1 upon L square. Check it, plus 1 by 3 kept as it is, differentiation of L square, giving me twice L. This is equal to 0. If you want, you can write M by 4 in the front, but since the whole thing is 0, it will not be coming into the calculation. Now from here, I can write next, well, the volume of the cylinder is pi r square L, so V by pi is coming out to be r square into L, isn't it? Once again, if V is pi r square L, V by pi is r square L that I put here, so r square L into minus 1 upon L square plus 2L by 3 is equal to 0. This L cancelling out, making it minus 1 by L inside brackets, little manipulation, and show that we are getting the ratio L by R is coming out to be square root of 3 by 2. And that is the option number 1. So we conclude that option, this is the correct ratio of L and R to make I minimum, and therefore option 1 is the chosen option by us.